If the legend is to be believed, then one of the grandest automobiles ever built was designed because an Englishwoman passed a comment to Ettore Bugatti. She said that though the Bugatti motor cars were certainly fast, they lacked the refinement and the luxury of some other makes, like the Rolls-Royce. Now, that may or may not have happened, but one thing did take place. Bugatti impressed the world with a car of such scale and scope that it will never be forgotten. That car was the Type 41 Royale. Hi, I'm Joe Kelly Jr. Welcome to the Car Room Magazine's Playing with Cars. Heinrich Bauer is a new player on the 118th model scene, and they've set out to do some grand work of their own. They've modeled Bugatti's personal Royale, the Coupe Napoleon. It's a pretty big model, and it's got quite a few tricks up its sleeve. Come on, let's check it out. The Type 41 Royale was meant to lend a certain regal note to the Bugatti name, with a scale and grandeur the likes of which the world had never seen before. Maybe it was a little too grand. Bugatti insisted on interviewing each potential owner to see if they were worthy of taking possession of a Royale, and he was known to turn away seated princes and heads of state. The cars were enormous, and only six were built between the years of 1927 and 1939. Seven if you count the car that Bugatti wrecked during a road test. They were also incredibly expensive. $20,000 got you a rolling chassis and drivetrain, and easily $10,000 more would get you one of the finer bodies built by some of the coach workers of the day. When you were done, you had a truly exclusive, truly remarkable automobile, and that's exactly what Bugatti intended. Bauer's model of the car is a very ambitious attempt at jumping to the head of a class dominated by companies like BBR, CMC, and Exotto. And it's a strong first effort that appears here as a pre-production sample, only the second one built from the new molds. Proportion-wise, it's a stunning and very large model car in 1:18, with all of the dramatic sweep of the Royale. There are opening front and rear doors with working latches and a butterfly hood, all on very good shut lines. The wheels steer and pose, and the suspension works. In addition to a great paint job, despite the scratches this sample's endured in its travels, there's a lot of jewelry on this one. There are these metal hasps and hood latches, these thumb screws on the windshield, and a removable spare tire. Thin-gauge stainless steel is used to form the bumperettes and the headlight bracing, and die-cast metal for the radiator shell. And the body itself is a hybrid mix of stamped metal, die-cast, and injection-molded plastic. There's a lot to see here. Lingering past the first impression, I like the big car's finer details, like the lensing and the headlight buckets, the nuts and bolts way the headlights are attached to the bracing, and the scale-correct hinges on the doors and on the hood. So far, this is really nice stuff. As a town car, the Napoleon was open at the front, and the area has been done well here with a beautifully stitched bench seat. It actually has scale give when you press down on the fine-grained leather. More leather covers the door panels, which are further decorated with this hardware detailing. These working latches are a hoot too, as is the delicate rear-view mirror, placed no doubt to allow eye contact with the occupants in the compartment behind. That rear compartment has undergone a lot of changes since the first photos of this model were made public, and it'll need to make just one or two more if it's to be correct. The wood console has opening compartments, and the luxurious velvet looks comfortable under the car's massive skylight. It is. It also has scale give when pressed with a fingertip. And check out the pull ropes at each upper corner. Very she-she. The first Royale built had a monstrous 900 cubic inch engine. Bugatti crashed that one, and subsequent cars were equipped with straight eights of only 765 cubes, making 300 horsepower at a leisurely 1700 RPM. When Bugatti failed to sell the planned 25 cars, 18 of these monster engines were used in locomotives, very fast locomotives. Here, Bauer's replicated the engine's machine-turned surfaces in a pattern that's a little too large to be correct, but still dazzles on display. Like on the real engine, the pattern is everywhere, even on the firewall. The detail under here is awe-inspiring, with some trim pieces fashioned from brake-formed metal. Large Bugatti ovals are in the shadows below, and the sparse cabling and plumbing follows the real car's aesthetic, a clean, uncluttered design above all else. The multiple linkages for the carburetor, a carb of Bugatti's own design, add punch to the area. This is a staggering bit of manufactured modeling. Those delicate linkages are the reason I'm not going to attempt the model's greatest parlor trick, the removal of its body from its frame. And I did it once for photography, and the lack of clear instructions made putting the car back together just a little bit scary. Now, because this is a loaner and it's a one-of-a-kind hand sample, I just don't want to take a chance on breaking anything. Forgive my caution with this one-of-a-kind model because the chassis is completely over the top in its detail and its scope, and I believe that it alone is made from as many parts as some complete car models. Every possible feature is here with an almost insane amount of noble materials used. Steel, brass, copper, and zinc have been machined, cast, pressed, and formed to represent, if not outright replicate, the giant Royale's equally enormous running gear. The suspension is fully linked and resists against steel springs. There are steel wires run to simulate the Bugatti's cable-operated brakes, and there's a full recreation of the car's mid-mounted transmission and exhaust system. Though static, every cable and linkage is here to see, unfortunately against a red frame, which Bauer says is there to further set off the detail they've built in. Okay, I'll go with that. This is a tremendous model. It's got an awful lot going for it. It's a cool subject, it's been done very well, and it's an impressive piece, just like the real Royale was. Now, that being said, I hope they take care of just a couple items before they go into production. One of those items is the rear seat fabric, which should have a fleur-de-lis pattern on it. The other is the road wheels. On this car, they were removable. I'm not entirely sure they were supposed to be, and I'm only saying that because there was no brake detailing or any detailing of any kind behind them. They also should have more of an aluminum look, not quite so chrome. It's a wildly impressive model, and it's going to come to market at a price of about $600, and it comes with an included wooden mirror-top display case. They're going to sell an acrylic cover for the whole thing, too, at an additional charge. Fun car. Thanks to Mini Champs North America for sending this review sample along. I've had a blast with it. Well, that's it for this episode of Playing with Cars. Thanks for coming down. For the Car Room Magazine, I'm Joe Kelly, Jr. Thanks for playing with cars. Take care. Bye-bye.